But before I hop into our passage and before I send our children to Kid Life, so don't leave yet, kids, not yet. Come on, Gavin, hold up. I do have one announcement I wanted to make on the front end, something that's really exciting and incredible news for our church. This Wednesday night, the personnel committee met, and they unanimously offered the children's director position to Jennifer Noble, which she accepted. Jennifer, would you stand up? Right. We are so excited about Jennifer coming on board with our team, and make sure and let her know how much you love her. She is going to do a fantastic job with the children. They already know her. She's been a member of this church for many years, and if you know her, you've been able to watch her grow in her faith, and so we are excited about her, her character. She has great integrity, and she will do a fantastic job. I do have a gift for you, something for you to read. Our staff is going through this book. Jennifer, I'll bring it to you later, but the book is called Lead. It's by Paul David Tripp, 12 Gospel Principles for Leadership in Church, Principles for Leadership in the Church, and so, Jennifer, we pray. Our hope for you is, as you lead in this program, this department of the children, our hope is that your life, your family would be shaped by the gospel, and your ministry would be shaped by the gospel. And so we're excited about what God is going to do in and through you. Now that said, kids, it's time. Kids, go with the rodents. Y'all have fun. We'll see you afterwards. Adults, and those kids who are left. Matthew 22, grab your Bibles, join me there. Matthew 22, we're going to be in verses 34 through 40. We're just going to look at a few verses, but that doesn't mean this sermon is going to be short. As you're turning there, though, Katie and I did something. I want you to see this. We did something yesterday. Maybe we did something? I think we did. I don't know. Yeah, we did something. That's Anna Claire with the newest addition of our family. That's Lily Fields, an 8-week-old mini Aussie. I mean, look at that girl. Not the dog, the actual human child. Now, that right there is just unfiltered joy, unfiltered love. I wish we could hold down the mouse because it's one of those live pictures, and you can hear her in the background cackling like a crazy witch because she's so excited about this dog. But if you look at the picture, it's not a two-way street, right? Lily is like not having it. She's like, why are you holding me this way? So we're working on how to hold the puppy. But in Lily's defense, last night, man, it was our first night with the dog, and Katie and I, whew, it was a payback for sure. Lily got us back at 11 p.m., 1 a.m., 2 a.m., 3 a.m., whimpering to be set free from her cage, kennel. She wanted it. So anyways, I'm just so thankful we captured that priceless picture. I showed it to you because today we're talking about love, right? Love. Love's the topic of the morning, and love is certainly considered the greatest of virtues. Would you agree? Like, there's nothing better than love. Like, the world knows this, the church knows this. Victor Hugo, author of, anybody know? There's a Disney movie about it. Huh? Okay, maybe. I'm not that cultured. Hunchback of Notre Dame. Okay, maybe that too. He said this. He said, life is the flower for which love is the honey. See, what he was getting at was what makes life sweet, what gives it color, if you will, what makes life worth living is love. That was Hugo's sentiment. We can take the picture off. It's sweet, but we can take it off. This all-consuming virtue, love, is what Jesus begins to dial us into this morning. He's going to dial us into love on the horizontal plane, right? Love between each other, and love on the vertical plane, love between us and God. That's what we're going to look at, the relationships. And so today's sermon is entitled The Great Commandments. Really simple. So if you're in Matthew 22, verse 34, say, uh-huh. All right, let's go then. It says this, but when the Pharisees heard that he, that is Jesus, had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Now, if you remember, if your brain can go back this far, a few weeks ago, I've been out of the pulpit 2 weeks, so I'm like, man, I've been rip-roaring and ready to get back in it. But if you can remember, 3 weeks ago, we met Jesus and the Sadducees. They had this little battle, right? And the Sadducees dropped this theological nuke on Jesus. And Jesus, in his incredible theologian way, he disarmed the nuke and he melted the brains of the Sadducees. And the Pharisees, remember, the Pharisees and Sadducees were not friends. And so in this moment where we read that the Pharisees heard that he silenced the Sadducees, it's probably the case that the Sadducees or the Pharisees had mixed emotions about it. Right, they hated the Sadducees. And so I'm sure they were happy that Jesus had silenced them. I'm betting if I were a Pharisee, I would have been there with my tablet. I would have been writing down everything Jesus had to say, because next time I debate with them, I'm going to drop the Jesus card. Like, I'm going to show them about the resurrection. I'm going to teach them what is true. Right, they were happy about it, but they were also probably unhappy. Have you ever heard that saying, the enemy of my enemy is my friend? All right, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. And so they were probably disappointed too, because they hated Jesus more than they hated the Sadducees. And so they gathered together, is what verse 34 tells us. And then they send out one from their ranks, what the Bible tells us is a lawyer. Now, a lawyer is another word in the Bible for a scribe of the Pharisees. So a lawyer and a scribe, they're basically interchangeable. And their focus was on the books of Moses, on the law, right? The first five books of Moses. They were experts trained in the law of Moses. And he shows up with a question to Jesus, a test. Look at it, verse 36. It says, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Now, a little background knowledge. There was this continual debate amongst the Pharisees and the religious leaders about the commands in the Old Testament, about what commands had substance and what were kind of immaterial, right? Kind of like a cloud. Which ones were weighty and which commands were lighter? And they argued about this all the time. They debated about it. In fact, in tradition, they said that there were 613 commands in the first five books of the Bible. And what they would do, they were so obsessed with the law, is they would categorize these things. They'd categorize some as positive commands, like honor your parents. Commands that you should do, positive commands. And then they would categorize others as negative commands, things that you should not do, like don't covet your neighbor's donkey, right? Those are negative commands. Don't do that. And so you can imagine with 613 commands, there was no uniformity on what was heavy and weighty and what was light, what was the most important, and which ones were maybe on Sunday, right? I'll take care of that on Sunday kind of commands. And so when he comes to Jesus and he says, which is the greatest commandment, when we hear that, we're like, why is that a test? But with all that in the background, all this debate, all this chatter, all this talk, he comes and he's trying to trap Jesus so that he could prove his understanding of the law was greater. All right, test Jesus with a question. Which is the greatest commandment in the law? Verse 36. And then Jesus answers in verses 37 and following. Look at what he says. He says, he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Like, Jesus looks at this lawyer, this scribe of the Pharisee, and he says, the big command, the big papa, right? The first and greatest is to love God. Is to love God. He points him back to the law of Moses. In fact, Jesus is he is quoting scripture, the Shema from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Shema is a Hebrew word for hear. And in Deuteronomy 6, we read this, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. The Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your might. That's what Jesus quoted. Jesus looks at them and he quotes them. Now here's what's he quotes that. Here's what's interesting though. I want you to get this picture in your mind. This scribe, according to Matthew 23:5, you can look there if you want in a minute. According to Matthew 23:5, this scribe most likely had a little box on his head, a little leather pouch, and a little leather pouch on his arm. It was called a phylactery. And inside that leather pouch and on his forehead and his arm, there was scripture passages. Now, I'm looking around. I don't see any leather pouches on our foreheads. No one wore that today, right? No. But, like, it's kind of weird. It's kind of a weird thing. We don't do that. But just show of hands, who rocked a fanny pack back in the fanny pack fad days? Come on, right? You chose this, or did the fanny pack choose you? Anybody? Look, Greg Sullivan's over there. He's raising it like this because he's so embarrassed. Any fanny pack wearers? Okay, you know, fanny packs have... they've made a comeback, right? Like everything from the 80s and 90s have made a comeback. Mom jeans, everything. So nowadays though, like you can be real cool. You don't have to rock the big fanny pack. You can get like the Athleta pack, right? It's like this stretchy nylon. So it's like real slender and cool like a belt, but then you can like put an elephant in there and you're good. You can rock it. So they had these phylacteries. They wore, so it's not that weird. I know we think about it like, who would do that, right? Some of you had tattoos on your face, or you know someone who did that. Anyways, inside this box, inside this little leather pouch, you know what scripture passage was in there? The Shema, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. Every day they would quote this to themselves, and every day they would wear it on their body. And Jesus says, that thing you're in your pouch right now, that thing, yeah, that's the greatest commandment. That's the big one. Church, the Jupiter of commands for us is for us to love God. As Jesus said, with all of our soul, with all of our heart, with all of our mind. And if you read the parallel account in Mark 12, he says to love God with all of our strength, all our might. Now, the point isn't that we divide ourselves up. Right? Imagine yourself in front of a magician and he gets the saw out. Like, that's not the point, to cut yourself up and think of yourself as a body and a heart and a soul and a mind. That's not what Jesus is saying. What he's saying is the way that we're to love God, the way that we're to love the Father is to be a comprehensive love. It's to infiltrate every recess of our person. It's to be all that we are. With all that we are to love him. So what's the big commandment, the lawyer asks? Jesus says, love God with an all-consuming love. All right, show of hands. Who loves lists and rules? You're like one of those people, like, give me the rules, give me the lists. Okay, for people like you, God love you. For people like you, this is clarifying, isn't it? It is. It's like, I know what God expects. I know what he expects. But this isn't just clarifying. I also think this is crushing. Think about it. In your mind, go back to a moment in your life that you can point to and you can say, right there, June 18th, 1997, I loved God with all of my heart and with all of my soul and with all of my mind and with all of my strength. Man, we're not all introspective. But we all know that there's not a moment in our life that we can point back to and we can say that we loved God with every fiber of who we are, is there? And it's just not. Like we can't point back to that place because it's impossible for us to do that. We know that we're a mixture of motives. Even sometimes as a Christian, right? Don't you do something and in the back of your mind, like you begin to think about what you're doing and you're like, oh, someone will see me do this. Someone will love me because I'm doing this, right? Like we're a mix of motives. We're a mix of emotions. We're a mix of choices. We are a grab bag of desires as a people. See, before the big command, love God with everything that we are, is a path for us to walk in intimacy and joy with the Father, is a mirror that reveals that we are not God and we are not good and that we need help. Right, John 3:19 and 20 says this, if I can get there. It says, and this is the judgment. The light has come into the world. That's Jesus. And people loved Jesus. No, people loved the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light lest his works should be exposed. We naturally, apart from the grace of God, we naturally love evil. We're like Adam and Eve, aren't we? When the presence of God comes near, where do we go? We don't stay put. We hide. We live in a sin-wrecked world. We hold our idols close, idols of comfort, idols of pleasure, idols of power, and we hope that they will fulfill everything that we desire, even though we've seen again and again how they fail us. They don't keep their promises, and those idols we hold on to, they prove to us again and again our own guilt and our own sinfulness before God, our hopelessness. We need God because we are not good. But praise be to God, right? Praise be to God that his love took the initiative. Romans 5:8, while we were sinners, Christ died for us on the cross. What we did this morning, remembering the cross in the Lord's Supper, on the cross, Jesus became our substitute. That he would take God's wrath, that he would perfectly obey, so that we could find obedience in him. He became that for all of us. See, the Bible says we love, 1 John 4:19, because he first loved us. So if we don't have the love of God poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, guess what? We won't be able to love like this. It will be impossible. What if I told you, hey, I need you to float to the core of the earth. I need you to eat logic. You'd be like, that doesn't even make sense. It's categorically impossible. And so is this command. If you've never met Jesus in a saving way, you can't do it. It is categorically impossible. It will be easier to eat the rules of logic than to keep this. I'm telling you that. So don't put the cart before the horse this morning. You need the grace of Jesus to love the Father. So I want to ask yourself this question. These two questions. Have I entrusted my life to Jesus Christ? Have I, big R, repented of my sinful lifestyle, turning my mind from the things of this world to the things of to Jesus? And have I, big T, trusted in Jesus as my only hope for salvation? You can't muster this type of love that Jesus says that we're to love the Father with unless you've experienced it and you've been given it by the Spirit. But as a Christian, you have God's love poured into your heart. You have the empowering Holy Spirit within you to help you live the life Christ calls you to live. And so I want us to run on these tracks to think about how we're doing loving God with our whole being. Let's start with what he says first in verse 37. You shall love the Lord your God, if you're taking notes, with all your heart. According to the Bible, the heart is the central operation station of your being. It's the control room that guides everything that you do. Right? Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Your life is a reflection of your heart. Everything you say, everything you do, everything you think, and everything you feel comes from your heart, as the Bible teaches. We are to love God with an encompassing love from our heart. And that should encompass our mind. We don't just love God with all of our heart, we love him with all of our mind. Here at First Baptist Church, we do our best. We do our best to assist you in loving God with your mind. We have we have a handful of lay teachers that prepare every week to teach biblically rich, theologically true studies, Bible studies in our Sunday morning groups. Like we care that your mind is dwelling on the truths of who God is. Let me ask you, are you taking advantage of our Sunday morning groups? Have you considered attending a Sunday morning group so you can grow in your love of God with your mind? This weekend, on Saturday, yesterday, Kim Watson led our women's brunch, and she taught right at 50 women theology about the goodness of God. 50 women getting together to think about the character and the nature of who our God is, to love Him with our mind. Loving God with our mind, it kind of sounds scary, doesn't it? Like, do I have to be an egghead? Like, do I have to be really smart? No, you don't. Case in point, right? You don't have to be really smart to love God with your brain, with your mind. What it means to love God with our mind is to dedicate ourselves to thinking clearly and truly about who God is, so that we don't have misinformation, false ideas about who He is. It's dedicating ourselves to the pursuit of who He is in the Word of God, saying every day, I'm going to pursue Him with my mind. I'm going to pursue who He is. Like, I don't want you to believe the narrative that to be a Christian means that you have to just have this blind faith and you just jump out and just trust. That is not what it means to be a Christian. The Christian faith is based on historically reliable evidence. In this book, we have the revelation of God. Yes, certainly. Certainly, the Christian faith is for the uneducated. But it is an educated faith. It's a faith that we can pursue God with our mind. In fact, will you ever know everything about God? No, right? To be God means He's greater than anything we can totally, completely comprehend. So we pursue loving Him with our mind. And here's what's awesome. When you begin pursuing Him with your mind, loving the Lord your God with your mind, here's what happens. Your affections for Him begin to be stirred, don't they? When you pursue the truth of God, you look clearly at who He is. What happens is God's Spirit uses that to inflame passion for Him. Loving God with our mind produces love in our soul. We're to love Him, Jesus says, with all our soul. Okay, do you remember, for my older folks in here, back when you were in the dating scene or the going steady scene, if your hair's really gray, right? Do you remember those days? High schoolers, junior high students, you probably are just in the midst of that. If you remember that season and when you were dating, when you ended up getting a boyfriend or a girlfriend, do you remember how that felt? Right? Mason Sullivan, you remember how it felt when you're just like floating across the, you're just like so happy. You're like floating an inch off the ground. Mason Meisner's like, yeah, I'm just so happy in my relationship. Like you're just, the sun is brighter. The flowers are sweeter. Everything in life has come to color. And all you want to do, right? All you want to do is be around that person. You want to talk to that person because you're just, man, you're smitten. You're smitten. And it's like you got an essay due, right? Sunday night, you got an essay due, and it's due in an hour, and you got five more pages, and you do the math, you're like, it's 12 minutes a page, but you're like loading up in your truck to take your girl to frozen yogurt. Like, that's how dating is, right? Like, you don't think with your brain, because you're smitten. When Jesus says that we're to love Him with all our soul, His intention, what He's tapping into is we're to love Him with our affections. We're to love Him with our desires. Like during those early years of dating, you didn't have to muster up those feelings, did you? In fact, some of you were probably a little too stirred. You know what I'm talking about? Like you needed to pull in the reins a bit, okay? The more we see the reality of who Jesus is, the greater we will go into joy in Christ. The other night, Katie and I were, we were talking, and she was picking on me because apparently when I'm tired, I get kind of passive aggressive, and I just say things that are like super passive. I don't know. I didn't realize this about myself, but she said something, and it dawned on me that this was so true, and I started laughing. I spit out my water. I'm in the kitchen, and I can't breathe. I'm laughing so hard, right? It was the probably the funniest she's ever been, ever. And about a minute into it, I finally catch my breath. And I look at her, and you know what? All I wanted to do was just pull her close, right? Just, I love you. Like, man, like I just, a new layer of Katie unfolded before me. I mean, we've been together 10 years. We've been married 10 years, dating all together 11. And I was just drawn to be closer to her, drawn to just that affection. Katie's an imperfect person, right? We all are, okay? I'm more imperfect than Katie. Katie's imperfect. But then think about the perfect, holy God. And the more of him that's unfolded to us in the Word, the more of him we see, his perfect holiness, his perfect beauty, his perfect goodness, by God's Spirit, it just stirs up something where we just want to draw near. Like, have you felt that in your relationship to Christ? You've seen something and you're like, man, I just want to see more. Like, I want to go out there and win the world to Christ. Like, radical abandonment. That's sometimes Christ does that for us as we learn more about him. And what follows is we begin to love him with all our might. Deuteronomy 6:5, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Jesus didn't include it, or Matthew didn't include it here, but in the parallel account, strength is in that one. In mid-April, so just a couple weeks ago, I attended an executive retreat. I'm a part of the Southern Baptist of Texas Convention. Yeah, boring. But I'm on that board. It's pretty cool. And a pastor came in from Champion Forest Hill Baptist. It's a humongous church in Houston. And he came and he preached a sermon for all us pastors and lay leaders. And his topic was work. And he said that when the church called him to be a pastor, they were interviewing him and they asked him this question. They said, hey, would you be willing on Sundays to preach 3 sermons? And he just said, well, yeah, of course I'd be willing. And they said, well, hold on. Like, that's a lot of work. Like, your voice is gonna get tired, you're gonna be taxed. Like, it's a lot of effort to preach 3 times in a Sunday for thousands of people every time. Like, are you sure it's not too hard? And the preacher, he said this to the committee. He said, my dad, he was a bricklayer for 40 years, and I couldn't with any integrity tell you that I couldn't give 3 30-minute talks every Sunday. You better bet I will preach 3 sermons every Sunday. What he was tapping into is this. Loving God with all of us includes working hard for God. And it means giving him, young people, listen to me. It means giving him the best of your years. And my older people, giving him the rest of your years. That's what it looks like. We don't look at the world and wish we had what they had. Amassing toys, using people, radically growing our nest egg. Last week, Trent coordinated and ran and planned this amazing DNOW. He did a great, incredible job. And the theme of DNOW was upstream. That as Christians, we live and go upstream from the culture. We're salmon, right? We're moving in a different direction, baby, right? That's where we're going. We are not like our culture. Our aims are kingdom-minded. And so we work hard with our strength that direction. And you can bank on this. Every ounce of sweat, every hour of sleep lost, every dollar spent for the kingdom in love of God with your strength will not be wasted. It is an eternal deposit for a reward that is waiting for you. Kingdom-minded. Like it's, now it's easy to think. This is for my list people, right? My type A people, listen to me. It's easy to think that, okay, I'm gonna love God with my mind, and then that's gonna stir up these affections in my heart, and then I'll serve him with my strength, therefore I'm loving him with all of my heart. Like it's this linear. Have you ever played Monkeys in a Barrel, Barrel of Monkeys, that Hasbro game? We bought it this weekend, and so we were playing it. And, you know, you get that monkey, the orange little monkey, and you scoop up a monkey. So you got two monkeys, you scoop up a third. It's the simplest game. Kids love it, though. If you got kids, young kids, get it. It's $4, right? You skip, pick up another, and you get this long line of monkeys if you're really good. You get seven or eight, and it's real linear, right? One monkey, and then the next, and the next. But that's not exactly how our love for God works. Right? Haven't you experienced it? You're reading in Scripture one morning, you're praying that God would speak to you through his word, and you see something and you're like, goodness gracious, I love him. And like that makes you want to read more and you're reading, and then you go out and you're serving him, and as you're serving him, he enlarges your heart for him, and you're wanting to get back in the word. And the way our love for God works is that it kind of enfolds on itself. That when we love him with our mind and our affections and then our strength, and then the strength serves our love for our mind and so forth, right? It's not necessarily linear. And so the greatest commandment is to love God. I know I've spent a lot of time there, and we won't spend very much time in love for neighbor, but we love God with everything we are. We're the consuming love. But then Jesus, like he goes a step forward, doesn't he? Like he answered the scribe's question, but he didn't answer, he gives more. Icing on top. All right, look at verse 39. He says, a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The second greatest command is that we would express love to our neighbor. Now don't be deceived. Jesus isn't saying you need to love yourself. Check that box off. And once you really love yourself, then you're in the right mind. You're in the right mentality to go out, and then you can begin loving your neighbor. Now, you can get that blog on Google, right? That's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying that we naturally love ourselves. Show of hands. Raise your hand if when your teeth feel grimy or you have something in them, you brush them. There's not near enough of you raising. Kim Scott, what's wrong with you? Kim Scott, I gave that up years ago. I'm fasting. Right? So you love yourself, right? So you brush your teeth, right? When you're hungry, raise your hand if you eat, okay? All right? It's okay to experience hunger from now and then. So you eat. When you're sleepy, you sleep or you try to sleep. Show of hands, right? You at least give it a go. Okay, when your toenails are really long, they're getting kind of creepy, you clip them. Show of hands. All right, good. We got some well-groomed people. I'm proud of you. Look, God has made us in such a way that when we're mentally sound, when we're healthy, we just naturally take care of ourselves. Like, we cherish ourselves. Like, think about the things you pursue. You love working on your car. You love mowing your grass. You take care of your home. You budget. Like, we take care of our things. Some of you in here have great hobbies. Some of you in here are coffee connoisseurs. Yeah, right? Mom knows, right? Like, some of you, I'm not going to name any names. Some of you in here love heating water to an exact temperature, like you test it so that when you pour it over the grounds, you get the perfect extraction from the bean. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that, right? Everybody has their thing. I like coffee too, right? Some of you in here, deacons, have a passion for Bigfoot. Like you talk about it all the time. You go to conventions. It's weird, but whatever. Teach his own. In the same way you love yourself, love your neighbor. That's what Jesus is saying. In the same way you would give medicine to yourself when you're sick, give medicine to your neighbor, right? Right, love your neighbor. So I have a picture. I saw some neighbor love happening Oh, this is great. So I don't know if you can see this or not, but we had two students. I told you thank you before the service started. I didn't tell you why. This is why. So we have two students here that made t-shirts, and on the t-shirts is Megan Murray's face. That's pretty interesting, right? We're really creative. And these two students who will go unnamed gave Katie wasn't a part of this. They just gifted Katie one of these shirts. They wanted her to be a part of this. And so as I was watching, here's what I realized. This was a creative way that these two students showed their love for Katie and Megan. To say, you've poured into me, you love me, thank you for loving me in Christ. And so these two students showed neighbor love. They loved their neighbor in a creative way. We can take that down. Unless you just wanted to stay up there, Megan. I didn't tell Megan I would do that. When we don't love our neighbor, we don't just break neighbor love. Remember Nathan preached 2 weeks ago, did an incredible job. He taught us that when we break a horizontal command, we also break a vertical command. Anytime we don't love our neighbor, we also don't love God as we're supposed to. 1 John 4:20 says this. It says, if anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. When we love people that we can see, it's a way of loving God who we can't see. That's John's point. You ever felt that stirring in your heart? The Holy Spirit's just knocking. He's stirring, telling you to do something, telling you to talk to that person, telling you to invite them, telling you to pay for them, telling you to move, and you don't. We've been there. I've been there. When we say no to that, we're not only sinning against our neighbor, we're sinning against our Father. Not only are we not loving our neighbor, we're not loving our Father. Now look at how the passage ends, verse 40. He says, on these two commands, love God and love your neighbor, depend all the law and prophets. I think this means that think of all 613 of those commands according to custom. All of the words in the Old Testament are just an expression of the love of God. Without love for God and love for neighbor, we can't obey the laws of Christ. Remember what Paul said? Without love, we're a clanging gong, a noisy cymbal, like we're just disturbing noise, right? You can have faith, you can have hope, but without love, right, you're just a clanging cymbal. And without love, we can't really even understand the meaning of God's commands. And so, church, know this. Love is inconvenient. Like, love is messy. Like, it's going to throw your schedule off. It's going to decrease your productivity. Like, loving people as Christ calls us to love them means pursuing them like Christ pursued us. It means going after them. Like, love can be exhausting. Make you lose hours of sleep. Give you nice silver hair. Right? It can be costly. It can cost you your time. It can cost you your energy. It can cost you your money. But it is the Jupiter of commands. And it sums up all of what God had to say in the Old Testament. Everything hangs on it. And so for the sinner and the saint this morning, here's the promise. Jesus is the one who perfectly loved the Father with all of his heart, and with all of his soul, and with all of his mind, and with all of his strength. And he loved his neighbors to the cross while we were sinners. And so let's rest in his obedience. And then because of his obedience, let us obey him, the big papa of commands. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word. God, we thank you for the great commandments, that we're to love you with all of our heart and we're to love our neighbor as ourself. God, this morning I pray that we would see that the beginning step, the first part of loving you with all that we are, is that we would know you. God, that it's impossible for us to love you if we don't have a saving relationship with your son, Jesus, and so let us get that right. This morning we'll have a time to do that. And for those in here who know your son Jesus, I pray that you would work in us a rest in your perfect obedience and then a desire to love you with a consuming love and to love our neighbor like we love ourselves. God, we love you and we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.